Hello and welcome to Enlightened World Network, One with the Earth. I'm your host today, Danielle Proulx, and I am so proud to introduce one of our friends that I met this year, actually, Dr. Tate, Deborah Tate, aka Dr. Deb.
Yeah, that resonates so much easier with me, Dr. Deb. Yeah.
Yeah,
casual.
So we'll be using Dr. Deb today.
Okay, perfect.
All right, so today she's going to share a little bit. The topic of today is going to be introduction to the spirit of shamanism. So a little bit, it's going to be a brief, you know, explanation, a little bit of the history of shamanism, its connection to nature, a few shamanic core teachings, how shamanic journeying helps heal ancestral trauma, and much more. And how accessing our power animal provides guidance and insight along one's path of healing. So welcome. Very happy to be with you.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
So I'm going to be, because we're live, I'm going to be checking my phone once in a while. So hold on. I'm going to make sure that we're there. We're live on the page.
So I'm glad you're behind the technology on this, Danielle.
And we are. So if you are watching live and you'd like to actually say a comment, say hi, go ahead. Don't be shy. I'll be checking once in a while. And it could be a question, actually. So don't, like I said, don't be shy. Go ahead. All right. So a little bit about Deborah. So Dr. Deb is the owner and operator of One with Nature and is a shamanic practitioner and teacher. She is also the founder of the Shaman Within, which is a long year shamanist study program and healing the sacred circle program. Thank you, Deb.
No welcome.
Deborah has traveled intensively gathering teaching and experiences from many different lineage, which fuels her passion for sharing and teaching. She has her master's degree in psychology and her doctorate in metaphysics. Deborah's desire within shamanism is facilitating one's path with heart to provide them with the best possible opportunities for personal growth and spiritual development. She also shares a passion with beading, working with hide designing, and making traditional powwow regalia, and a love of nature, of course, right? She currently resides in Shiging First Nation in Manitoulin Island in Northern Ontario, Canada. So, okay, I have a question for you.
Absolutely.
So you're talking about a brief history of shamanism. So I want you to share a little bit about the history of this, because we hear this word all over now. It's getting more popular. But I don't think everybody knows where, you know, the history, where does it come from?
Shamanism. So they say, you know, it originates in Siberia, over in that part of the world. And, you know, it, when you say that, we're hearing that word much more frequently and common. When I started 26 years ago, no one had ever heard of shamanism. And me included, when I heard the name, it really, you know, resonated with my spirit. However, I didn't even know what it meant. So, I mean, shamanism is a nature-based study. We work with the plant worlds, the plant medicines, which is becoming more common. We work with the animal world, the four-leggeds, the winged ones, right? They provide a lot of medicine for us in relationship to their hides, with their feathers, right? The eagle feather is regarded very highly, right? We work with the elements, the waters, the water spirits, the earth, the air, the fire. We're working with all of nature. And we use it in our medicine. We use it for our healing ceremonies. You know, when we go out on a fast, a vision quest, we're with nature. It's just us and nature, right? So it's getting back to basics. When shamanism first, you know, was brought to mankind, however that happened, right? The shaman in the community was the psychologist, the doctor, the counselor, you know, the shamanic helper, the psychopomp. They did everything. Medicine men and medicine women in the community, they did it all. Midwife, death doula, right? You called the shaman. And so it was very common. Every community had a shaman or two or three, right? That worked and collaborated together. It's wonderful to learn. It's interesting because I liken, you know, shamanism, because it is all over the world, like a wagon wheel.
Okay.
So you have a center hub, and from that hub, there's all kinds of different spokes. Those are all the different, you know, studies of shamanism, whether it's the plant world, the mineral world. We work with crystals, our drums, you know, that's the shamanic journey, using, you know, that repetitive percussion and frequency of the drum or a shaker, right? That puts one into an altered state of consciousness.
Okay.
And so, and then of course, you know, we use the shamanic journey to go to the different landscapes, right? Where we have to do our work. So we use some power animals. We use, you know, we could use ancestral guides in human form from the upper world, angels, archangels. Family members, right, can be our guides. We use animals from the animal kingdom, right? So we refer that to that as the lower world or the animal world. And we do work in the middle world here, as we do our healing work in the middle world. So we utilize all the different landscapes as well as all of nature.
Okay.
I mean, the trees talk to us.
I'm listening to you and I'm like, whoa, there's a lot of component. Like, it's not just a practice. Example, I use EFT, like it's EFT, and you learn about EFT. You learn about so much. Like, it's vast. It's huge.
Yes. It's when you think about it, because it's a nature-based study and walk.
Yeah.
I mean, nature is huge when we, you know, I mean, I'm looking out my window. I'm looking at Lake Mindamoya and the trees and the grasses, and I got a lot of medicines here. So it is in the squirrels and the birds. Yeah. It is all medicine, right? Yeah. So, you know,
wow,
it is huge.
Yeah, thank you for describing it like this, because I think it's important to know, and that's why you have a year long program. So I can imagine you need that time to integrate all of that too and experience it, right?
Yes.
So when you mentioned you have to do your work, I wrote it down because I'm like, okay, so what does that mean? You have to do your work.
So, all right. And that's a really good question, because, you know, we work with people that have different sicknesses, illnesses, and diseases. I'm actually working with one of my students who is going through cancer. And she made the choice not to go the Western medicine way. She made the choice to go the shamanic way. So she's got shamanic work to do. So, you know, Danielle, when you said it's not just like you do EFT, and I understand EFT because I studied it, you know, briefly, right? It's not my forte. It's totally like, you know, I loved it. It's not just a weekend workshop. It's a journey. It's the journey of the soul, shamanism. It's not a destination. It's a lifetime. After 26 years, I'm still learning. I'm still doing. I have such a quest for shamanic knowledge, right? And which is why I'm still learning. It's the shamanic work is our inner work. It is exploring those shadows where we haven't yet shone the light. Mm-hmm. So it is rewriting our story, the story that we've been holding, the armor that we carry from. And it stems from childhood, right? Our influences, our social, family, religious, all of those influences shape and sculpt and mold us, right? As a child, we grow up, you know, watching our parents and learning our coping mechanisms and our patterns, our behaviors, whether we are able to put up boundaries and such. So the shamanic work that's the actual inside personal self-development and spiritual empowerment.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That's why you need a guide. You need somebody to, you know, to have as a reference too, right?
I have to share this. I share this with my students because when I first got into shamanism, and I remember sitting in the longhouse, right? And there must have been like, you know, close to 30 of us. And we're, you know, they're all sharing their stories. And I'm thinking, oh my God, what am I doing here? Everybody is so screwed up. Right. And not realizing like, duh, right. I have a story too. Right. I just didn't have the courage or the willingness to share it at that time. And little did I know that, you know, it is a journey. I have done, I can't even begin to count the ceremonies that, you know, I've done personally, mm-hmm. right. To help me, you know, shed and confront the shadows and the fears and the closed symbols and the dark mirrors and all of that. Right. Mm-hmm. And that just that allows our inner light to shine brighter.
Mm, yeah.
Right.
And I love that you mentioned, you know, I'm on a life quest. Like that's what it feels like after 26 years. And it's a journey.
It is.
And I'm glad to hear that. And I just want to say hi to acknowledge that those that are looking, there's Gail. Hi, Gail. Hi, Monique. Thanks for being with us.
And, yes.
For those that are going to watch the replay, we're still saying hi.
Right on.
So if you have any questions, any comments, for those that are at their live, go ahead. I'll be checking the phone once in a while and asking Dr. Deb here. All right. So I have a burning question, another one.
Sure.
We're talking. I'm like, okay, can everybody have access to this? Meaning, does it have to be Indigenous people?
Oh gosh, no, you know, we're all born shamans. We're all born one with nature. Oh. We're all born with that innateness. Mm. Like, you know, just like we're born like as sovereign beings, that sovereignty includes that oneness with nature and the universe. Mm. So anyone and everyone can practice and walk that journey. Absolutely. Right. So it's a calling.
Mm.
And I teach mostly non-Indigenous people.
Okay.
Right. I feel blessed to be able to teach shamanism. Mm-hmm. I have seen so many transformations, you know, where we have a saying in shamanism that, you know, when one is at a very, very low place, and maybe doing, you know, self-abusing themselves, maybe not eating, just not in a good place, right? Maybe caught up in struggles with addiction and our drugs and such, like they're almost stalking death. Mm. And I've had a couple of students as such, and, you know, what they're doing today, they're just a fire to be contended with, right? And that's because they actually made that connection to their own spirit. And it was through shamanism, right? It was through that learning and growing and healing and transforming and shape-shifting and transfiguring.
Yeah, and you get to see the transformation.
My God. And that's the blessing, mm-hmm. right? That is the total blessing. And, you know, in our changing times, how I was taught by one of my teachers. I've had like great teachers. I've been so blessed with my teachers. And Sandra Ingerman, I don't know if you've ever heard of Sandra Ingerman. She's been practicing shamanism for some 40 years. And she's just quite wonderful. And I blessed the time that I actually met with her, but yes. Everybody and anybody is capable of the journey, right? Sometimes it takes a little longer, but
yeah. Thank you for answering my question. And I'm just going to go back here because somebody said, Leanne said, I had the very similar question as Danielle. This is not a culture like the red path. It's not a spiritual path. It's like, it's our own, like you really explained it really well. So I'm glad I asked the question. Thank you.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, it's a path, and you're called to that path, the same as Buddhism, you know.
Yes, and she has another question. Is shamanism a spiritual path and not a religion?
Yeah, shamanism is a spiritual journey.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks for the question, Leanne.
Thank yes, you. Absolutely, Leanne. Thank you for that.
All right. So I have another question.
Sure.
So you said you started this journey around 26 years ago. Can you share with us for us to understand, like, how did you end up discovering that practice?
You know, how this happened was I had ended a 27-year-old marriage. And I was sitting, and I remember just like, you know, I'm visualizing it right now. I lived in London. We're sitting in Wortley Village, if anybody knows London, South London. We're having tea on a patio outside. And she's a spiritual counselor, a very dear friend of mine, Anne. And she was at that time taking Gestalt therapy training. And because she was a family and youth counselor. So she's reaming off all these things she's learning. And I'm like, oh, that's awesome, awesome. And then she mentions the word shamanism. She keeps talking. And I'm like, whoa, back up, Anne. She goes, what? I said, what was that word you just said that started with S? And she said, well, Deb, I've been talking for 10 minutes. Like, what are you talking about? And I said, I don't even know what word you said, but it struck a chord. So she's backing up, mentioning this. And she goes, you mean shamanism? And I'm like, bingo. What is that? She goes, I have no idea. I'm like, well, how do I find out? She said, well, they're having an open house. This was in Toronto. And she said, I'll talk to Jay, which was one of her teachers in Gestalt training. And she said, I'll let you know. So I made the journey to Toronto. And 26 years later, I'm still here teaching now. So when I got into the longhouse, it was the energy. And it was, you know, I don't know. Her name is Gail Carter. She was the most fabulous teacher I've ever experienced. And she was my worst tyrant, but that they just push us, you know, to our excellence. And I was a single mom raising two kids, working three jobs. And I used to count mushrooms when I was at the grocery store, right? And so I said, well, I don't know financially how this will work coming to Toronto and so on and so forth. She goes, you know, Deborah, she said, when it's meant to be, it is. And so she said, just take the registration form and think on it and see what happens. And so it actually worked out that, you know, I took my income tax to my dad's accountant at, you know, his request. He said, rather than like doing it yourself, just take it, you know, to my accountant and let him do it. So I've been attending university in different courses. And when I went to get my refund, he goes, well, you did really well this year. And I'm thinking, oh, I got $300 or $400. Woohoo. Right. That's great. And so he went, well, no, it's a little more than that. So anyway, it was enough to pay tuition and just carried me through the first year. And so it was like, you know, that learn. I mean, I didn't have faith in myself at that time in the creator. I didn't understand the five hawakas, right? Which is a teaching of happiness and good health and humor and hope and harmony with all things, right? So through the years, I just kept going back and doing ceremony. I would go twice a year for ceremony. I couldn't get it enough because I was learning and connecting to myself. Yeah. So that's how my journey started. And it's definitely a calling.
Yeah.
And I'm still at it.
And you said something while I was at the end, you said, you know, I kept going. Did you say I kept going every year, every 2 years?
I just kept going back every year.
Okay.
And then every time they offered something else, I like, you know, I took shamanic counseling and techniques, healing techniques. I did a Raven's Call, which was a woman's lodge. I was on the healing team. So I was learning. I was on the Black Lightning team, which was martial arts. So I was traveling to Toronto to help with sweats. I couldn't get enough. And I remember driving home at like 2 or 3 in the morning and two or three, four times a week, and then getting up for 7 to go to work.
And you had children.
I had two kids. Yes. Well, I still have two kids, but yeah, I was raising them at the time. They're on their own now, but yeah. So, I mean, you know, it just, it worked. Mm-hmm. Cause I wanted it to work. So I, yeah.
So today, are you doing this full time? This is what you're doing.
This is my life. This is what I do. This is what I do. So, yeah.
It's beautiful. This is who you are, right?
This is who I am. And, you know, as Sandra said, it's not what we do. It's who we become.
Mm-hmm. Right. And we can definitely feel it and see it when you're explaining all of this to us.
Wonderful.
I know I can feel it. And I'm sure the other people are going to sense the same thing. So, right. And I know that you've traveled a lot.
Mm.
And you do virtual training also now.
Yeah.
So it's international.
Oh my God, that's a real learning journey. That's a learning curve. I'll tell you, I just got a cell phone. I just got a cell phone like 4 months ago, and it freaks me out. You know, I mean, it'll ring and I'm like, what the heck is that? And it's the cell phone, and it's like, oh, how do you turn it on? How do you, oh my God. I've, you know, stopped, just hung up, I guess, on more calls, and I'm supposed to answer it, but oh my God, the arrow's going this way, that way. Oh man.
Well, it's good that you mentioned that. So whoever calls you, if they're interested in getting some work done with you, please call back.
Well, that, you know, I always say, don't call me. I don't give my number out because, oh my God, be lucky if I can answer it. But yeah, email me.
Yeah, that's the best way, right?
Yeah.
And speaking about courses online, so I know that you've got a lot on the go right now. Mm-hmm. And so can you tell us a little bit what's going on with the courses? Like what you got starting down the road, what's coming up?
Yes. So this is the first year I've offered the Shamanic Practitioners year-long program. And it just, I have had just wonderful response to it. It's actually almost full. I think there's only a couple spots left. And that's teaching basic and advanced shamanism.
Okay.
And like, as Sandra said, we need to teach as many practitioners that are called to the medicine, right? So that shamanism, you know, will be the mainstay of medicine, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And so I'm doing that. And I will be offering Healing the Sacred Circle. Now, Healing the Sacred Circle is a personal empowerment. It's the one learning about, you know, how to shed the armor and finding that light within, right? That gives you that direction without. I'm not sure whether it's going to be November. I haven't quite decided yet. And I'm offering Introduction to the Spirit of Shamanism for those that have no background in shamanism and are curious or intrigued about it, right?
Yeah.
Just learning the different shamanic landscapes and journeying their power animal, a little divination. And in the winter, I'll be offering shamanic counseling and healing techniques. So, so I'm just kind of mixing it up rather than what I've been doing the last 3 years, kind of added something new and it's working.
Nice.
So I'm pleased with it, right? So, yeah.
You opened the door to a lot more people having access to what you're offering, which is beautiful. So thank you for doing that.
Absolutely.
Out of your comfort zone.
Well, oh my, yeah, big time out of my comfort zone.
If you don't mind, would you talk about a little bit about, because we do have time, I'd
sure.
love for you to talk about power animals. What is
well,
it exactly?
So, you know, I'm gonna follow the Deer Tribe teaching, how I was taught. When we incarnate with a wheel of animal spirits. And so we have eight of them in the four cardinal and non-cardinal direction that help us assist us when we're born. And we'll walk with us through our journey this lifetime. And we have a power animal that it resonates and represents our soul. So our power animal, when someone hears about your power animal, or I hear about a power animal, it tells me a lot about that person.
Okay.
Right. The power animal journeys with me on my journeys, no matter what work I have to do, because I have different guides that I work with. Power animal is always there, right? Overseeing for my safety and giving me guidance, you know, intuitive guidance, will speak to me telepathically, right? So whatever clarity I require, that power animal is always there.
How do you access that power animal?
Through the shamanic journey.
Okay.
Yes, through the shamanic journey. Now, sometimes people are not, you know, open to the journey themselves, so they can actually go to a practitioner that does offer that, and she will journey either with the client or for the client to access that power animal.
Okay.
It really empowers a person when they, and you know, a lot of times their power animal, they've already resonated for a long time with that specific animal. And now they make that, you know, connection.
Okay. And how do you resonate? Do you see pictures of it? You just feel like it? You just feel it?
So I'll share a story. I did a power animal retrieval for Anishinaabe Kwe, from a tick machine. And hers was a big black gorilla. And I knew exactly what he looked like. He was just, you know, he's majestic. And so after the journey, I shared that, and she's like, I didn't know what that reaction was at first. I thought, is she scared it because it's a gorilla? She went, and she actually teared up. She said, Deborah, you won't believe this. And I'm like, oh, well, try me. So she said, my computer background is a gorilla.
I got chills.
I know. And she said, I've always had a connection to the gorilla. And she said, I never knew why. And now I do. And I said, well, he's your power animal. And you know, each animal, Charmaine's really good with this at the Tree of Life. She does the animal spirit readings. So, you know, they carry strong medicine, and that represents, you know, our gifts that we came into this world with.
Yeah.
So there's that, you know, innate divine connection.
So it's okay to be curious and go read and just follow our instinct. And you might say, I think it's this, you know, I think.
Yes.
It might be that animal.
Yeah. And I had a student that she wasn't a visual, like not everybody is visual. I'm very visual. You know, when I learn and when I teach, I'm always, you know, animated and visual, and she's more audio. So she was having difficulty because she was trying to envision her power animal.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, instead of forcing that vision, because maybe you're not a visionary, right? So maybe your audio or tactic or, you know, kinesthetic. So I said, what do you experience in your journey? She says, I hear the chickadee. And I said, well, have you ever asked that chickadee, when that chickadee is singing, if that is your power animal? And she went, no. So I said, well, let's journey. And I said, if the chickadee comes and starts to sing, ask that chickadee if it is your power animal, right? And because she resonated so much with the chickadee, and I can so relate to that, because she's a very tiny little lady, but boy, she's got a spirit as strong and fierce, you know, because you see that little chickadee and it's got this big voice that comes out, right? Everybody know, oh, that's a chickadee, right? And it comes from this little teeny bird. So she just totally represents that spirit and that medicine, right? She was just like, oh my God, it's the chickadee, right?
And does it follow you all your life? Does it change?
No, the power animal follows us on this journey.
Okay.
So the animals that surround your circle, they're always there, but they can come and go. Other ones can come in, you know, depending on what you're dealing with, circumstances in your life, right? because they all have whole different medicines and teachings.
Okay.
So yeah, but the power animal represents your soul this lifetime.
Okay. We have another question. So are power animals the same as your animals on your totem pole? I have walked the red path for over 25 years. So I love learning about this also. I am a white woman, but follow the red path. I feel that if I am more directed in this way of life, I will also resonate. It would also resonate with me. So the question, thank you, Leanne. The question is your power animal the same as your animal on your totem pole?
So when you say totem pole, so for me, that has a different teaching than our circle.
Okay.
So, yeah. So a lot of times the totem pole represents the community.
Okay.
Right. So the clans.
Okay.
So I don't have that teaching on the totem pole. It's difficult for me to speak on that. Yeah. Right. Because I wouldn't want to give out the wrong information. Mm-hmm. So I'm really not sure how to answer that question, honestly, right? With integrity. So I can only go from the teachings I've received, but that's a really interesting question.
Yeah.
Right. I have to learn more about that totem pole now. I've seen them.
So thank Leanne for that.
Okay. Thank you, Leanne. You've sparked something in me.
So maybe she can reach out to you or you can reach out.
Yeah. That is awesome.
Yes, it is. So, and I heard that there is also Oracle cards in the making.
Yeah. So supposedly I'm taking a year off here, but I'm working my butt off this month, but I am actually moving forward with that. And it's an Oracle deck, 44 card deck. And it keeps evolving because, you know, for years, when we have a full moon, I get woken up usually about 2:33-ish in the morning. And I used to struggle with it. And so I spoke with an elder from Birch Island that I know well. And she said, you know, Deborah, when the grandmothers wake you up, they have something to teach you. And I'm like, well, don't they work 9 to 5? And she said, no, right? They're 24/7. So I'm like, well, okay. So she said, from now on, instead of struggling with it, you know, wake up with appreciation that they have something to share with you. So I've been doing that for quite a few years now. And so they keep evolving my project. So it started out with, you know, an image and a word and a little blurb. And now it's gone from that image to the word to the blurb and a ceremony to integrate the teaching.
Whoa, that is completely different. I've never heard of that.
Yeah. So, you know, because there's a lot of ceremonies that we can do that really can resonate with our spirit. Mm-hmm. Hugging a tree is one of the most beautiful things that we can do. Heart to heart, because the trees have so much to teach us, right? And have been through so much. So, I mean, nature is our teacher, our greatest teacher. So, right?
Wow. So I can't wait. So anticipation, date.
I honestly, I don't have a date. But so I'm really looking to for like 2022. I'm putting out there. I'm putting
that
out there.
That's all right. So they can find it out. They'll find it. You'll announce it, right?
Yes. Like, you know, for sure. They'll be at the tree.
and also there's a book
coming. Yes. Yeah. There is a book. And I walked the Camino in Spain in 2012. And I had divine intervention every day. It was such a spiritual journey, right? You know, such a spiritual, impactful journey. And I was told on that walk that, yeah, you have written that book already. So it is, you know, you now have to basically find that book. So you have to write that book because it's been created already, right? In the upper realms. So now you have to bring it into the physical. So I look forward to that, right? I have a lot of ideas. Sandra has given me a lot of insight because she's written 12 books and she's on her 13th book. So she gave us a lot of insight in teacher training on, you know, if we were wanting to write a book. And I mean, I'm an English teacher by trade, so I actually should be familiar with writing. But so, yeah, that'll be, you know, that's the last big hurrah, I think. So writing that book, and I don't know how long that'll take. But yeah, I look forward to that. I'm really excited about that. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's the yeah. Well, can I say the title?
Of course you can.
Oh, so it's Soul to Soul, A Woman's Journey Home. So, but the soul to soul, the first soul is the soul of the foot.
Okay.
So soul to soul in the spirit. So in other words, every step we take with our soul, our foot, leads us to the soul within and the journey home.
Nice.
So what has transpired between each step that I've taken in my life has created the soul that I, you know, that I now represent.
That is beautiful. And that you got the inspiration and you got the message while you were doing your walk.
Exactly.
It's pretty powerful. So
yes.
Listen, we'll be looking out for Soul to Soul.
Yeah.
Someday coming out, you'll have to come out back here and tell us, okay, gang,
here it is. Here it is. Yeah. I have to think of the image. I'm just not sure of the image yet. So I have to work with that.
Yeah. Leanne said, oh, you know what? My teachings, she said, love the title of your book. Thanks, Leanne.
Oh, thanks, Leanne. What a sweetheart.
Yes. Yes, she is. And actually there's other people. So I'm saying hi to them too. Thanks for being with us, and don't be shy, put your comments, put your questions,
for sure.
Dr. Deb will be happy to answer it, and if she can't, she'll follow up eventually with you. And for those that are going to be watching the replay, you can actually actually put the comments, and I'll make sure that Dr. Deb gets them under the video. So don't worry about it. Even if you missed a live, you can still ask your questions or directly to Dr. Deb also, because the best way to reach you, right, is your Facebook page.
Yes, One with Nature.
Okay, and I did put the link right underneath the video so people can just click directly on it. They don't have to look for it. So,
okay, perfect. Yeah, thank you.
That will make it easier. Okay. And I want to know a little bit more about when you talk about ancestral trauma.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's one of the things that you mentioned while you're doing this work.
Mm-hmm.
Now, and you talk about the lower world, the upper world, the mm-hmm. middle
world. Yeah.
Is it all connected? Is it?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. It's the whole landscape, right? That's the lower world or the animal kingdom, the middle world and the upper world. It's the landscape of the universe, right? And that those are the landscapes that we traverse for healing. So the shamanic journey can bring a lot of healing to a person that is working with ancestral trauma, right? They get a lot of guidance because they learn who their compassionate helpers are. They meet their compassionate helpers from the different worlds, and they get a lot of knowledge from those guides and their power animals, right? That can really help with that ancestral trauma so that we can actually, you know, take them back to the ancestors. And we can and deal with that trauma and finish it and leave it so that we don't have to continue to bring it forward and live it in our present life.
And your power animal can assist you with that also.
Absolutely.
And you know Absolutely. What? I'm losing half of your face here because it's dark.
Oh, okay. So can you, can I turn a light on? Can you give me a minute?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. I'll be right back.
And while you're doing, you can still hear me. We have Monique that gives us a thumbs up, gives you a thumbs up, actually. And we got Gail that says, thank Dr. Deb. I sure hope to connect with you soon.
Oh, is that Gail from North Bay?
Gail Cook?
Gail Cook! Oh my gosh! Hi, Gail!
So thanks for being with us, Gail.
Is that better?
Yeah, well, that's okay. It's better. It's not as black. Maybe you can be closer to the camera. That's it.
Okay, give me a sec. All right. Give me a sec.
That's what happens, right? When the light, the sunshine leaves.
Oh, is that? Is that any better?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh my God.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So, thank you very much. So right now you're actually working on the internet virtually. You're doing some one-on-one, you're mm-hmm. doing some groups, you're doing some courses, but you're also working at the Tree of Life, right?
Well, yeah, I've actually been on hiatus, so I'm actually taking a year off. So I've been in Antigua and doing some kind of like volunteer missionary work and doing my Oracle deck, right? So
pretty busy.
There's no relaxing, okay? And people go, am I retired? And I'm like, what does that word mean? Retire? I don't know that I'll ever retire, right? Because I like to always be helping people, right? I mean, hence I became a teacher and then a counselor and, you know, psychologist. And it's like, so that's my passion, is to help people. And I noticed, you know, when I was down there and I wasn't doing my medicine work as much, that it really, you know, created a void. And so, you know, and I've been at the tree. I just love the Tree of Life. It's just it's a beautiful healing space. You know, Charmaine has created an amazing, amazing energetic space for, you know, people just to come and de-stress if they have to, right? And just speak with people down there and you know, camaraderie and brotherhood, sisterhood. I really miss the tree, I must say, right? Because I had quite a few clients coming in. You know, however, it's a year and life changes and we grow and do different things. And it's part of our path. It's part of our journey, right? So.
And you're talking about the Tree of Life is in Sudbury, Ontario, right?
Correct. Sorry. Yeah.
No, that's okay. I wanted to mention it. And sorry. I wanted to mention it. And just because people might say, well, where is it? Because you're all over the place right now.
True. Yeah. Yeah, that's true. So it is in Sudbury. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And I know I'm putting you on the spot right now.
Oh, that's all right.
But I know you can handle it. No problem. If you were to finish this interview together here with one word or a sentence or a paragraph of words of wisdom, what do you want people to know before we say goodbye?
So, you know, that's a really loaded question.
Yes.
However, what I would say, what I will say is take the time to learn about who you are, because we all have a beautiful light to shine. And I know that in these changing times, it's been, you know, difficult for a lot of people. However, you know, spend as much time in nature, because she has a really incredible healing effect and she shares a lot with us. You know, the water spirits, the plants and the trees, and you know, I actually facilitated a wedding today, and the bride said, "Oh, you know, I've never seen an eagle," and they had two children, Margot, who is 19, and Aiden, who is 7, and he goes, I don't know, Mom, whether the eagle will come and see us." And I said, "Well, you know, Aiden, if you pick up that drum, there's an eagle that lives out there on that island that you see in the middle of Lake Mindamoya." He goes, "Really?" And I said, "Oh, yes." And I said, "He comes to visit sometimes. If you play that drum, he's going to hear that drum." And he's going to come in and because he's going to be curious, who's playing that drum? And because that drum resonates with his heartbeat. So he went, really? And I said, yes. So he was playing the drum all through the ceremony, right? And I actually had a session with the husband, and when we were finished, we went out to the lake because that's where they were sitting. And Aiden said, "Dad, you wouldn't believe who came to visit me." And of course, his dad said, "Who?" And he goes, "The eagle. He flew right across the lake. I watched him. He flew right across the lake from that island, and he came right over to me, and then veered around." And flew back.
Wow.
And I said, see, he heard you playing the drum. He was just probably finishing lunch. And then he was going to come and see who was playing that drum. Right?
Yeah.
So, you know, take the time to sit with yourself. Take the time to sit with nature. Mm. Right? And because she has a wonderful way of de-stressing us and just listen to, you know, her silence. There's a song of silence.
Oh, that's interesting. And a song of silence.
Yeah, there's a song of silence when you, if you close your eyes and listen, whether it's the water lapping on the shore, whether it's the hummingbirds, you know, you hear their wings, there's a song. The leaves flutter.
Oh, I'm gonna do that tomorrow. Tomorrow morning, I've got beautiful birds. You should see the music in the morning.
Yeah, isn't that incredible? It's an orchestra.
It's beautiful.
And that it feeds our soul. It feeds our soul, right? It really sets us up for the day, right? To like, you know, it's very empowering and it's like, okay, I got this.
Yes.
I got this.
Thank you. Thank you for reminding us to just slow down. So keywords that I guess I needed to hear. Thank you. Slow down, go back to nature, silence, the song of silence. I love it.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
I have another question here. So Gail, sure. You bet to seeing you, right?
Yeah.
And then there was a Catherine that asked, can you share a little about how you will be channeling your book?
Wow, that's a nice, isn't that, I never thought about channeling it, but you know, wow. It's my journey. Okay. So, you know, my soul is going to, you know, I guess connect with this part that's going to be doing the writing. So it's coming from my soul and the journey that I've walked, the steps I've taken from, you know, the beginning to, you know, our journey home. And I'm still not home, but it's the journey towards home. Like, you know, is
wow.
So
yeah, it's your soul channeling you.
Yeah, exactly. So I wasn't really thinking about working with, you know, someone from the up above. But I mean, who knows? I mean, I'm sure the grandmothers and grandfathers and, you know, the water spirits, the trees are going to give me insight as well. Yeah. Right. I mean, sometimes I get insight just sitting out there watching the hummingbirds, just observing, right. Observing life and listening to the silence. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Catherine, for the great question.
Absolutely.
So I want to give you a big virtual hug and say thank you so much.
Yes, you're welcome so much.
To, you know, chat with us, to give us more insight. And I encourage people, if they want to, you know, chat with you, find out more about your courses, about what you can do with them, how you can help them on their path to healing, right? Path to healing. The best way is through your Facebook. I'm just going to say it again, One With Nature. And I did put the link underneath the video. If not, give me a little comment, give me a little something, and I'll definitely send it to you. And wishing you a beautiful, beautiful day, rest of the day in silence, in love, and in gratitude.
Yes. Jimmy Gretsch. Jimmy Gretsch, Danielle. It was wonderful. Thank you, everyone.
We might do another one later down the road. Who knows?
Okay. You just let me know. You know how to reach me.
So thank you for all the viewers. Thank you for those that were live. Thank you for those I'll be watching after. And hopefully you're going to learn as much as I did today. So see you soon.
Thanks. Bye.